standing, please. Hallelujah, find the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, find the glory. Revive us again.
We praise thee, O God.
We praise thee, O God.
For the Son of thy love.
Jesus who died, Lord Jesus who died,
and is now gone above. Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep. It is our prayer this morning that you would revive us again, that you would rend the heavens, and that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, and that he would fill us until we're overflowing, and to our lips offer praise and thanksgiving and blessing to the name of our God. That he would fill us into the joy of the Lord would just flood our souls like the rushing of many waters. That he would fill us and that he would cleanse us from every sin, from every encumbrance, from every impediment that keeps us from worshiping you in spirit and in truth and in the beauty of holiness. That he would fill us, O God, with glory, to be witness with our words, with our walk, and with our lifestyles, with our conduct. That he would fill us, O God, with glory, that we would sense that we were almost raptured into the very throne room of God, fellowshipping and communion with the true and with the living God. That he would fill us, O God, with glory, to every high thought, Father, every idea, every imagination of our minds would be brought captive in obedience to the living, resurrected Christ. He would fill us, O God, with glory, that with the consuming passion of our lives would be to worship you and to adore you and to serve you. And as the psalmist wrote, as the deer pants for the water brooks, so our souls pants. We long, we yearn with an insatiable desire for thee, O God of glory. Nothing else can separate us from you, Lord. And nothing can satisfy the longing of our souls but fellowship and communion with the living God. Material trinkets cannot satisfy, O God of glory. The lusts and gossips of this world cannot satisfy us. We cannot be satisfied apart from the living waters and apart from the bread of life, the Lord Jesus Christ himself. So we pray, O God of glory, that you would fill us, and that you would fill this place with your presence, with great heaviness, until every soul would realize that God is in our midst. And if there be one among us who's never come to faith in the living Christ, that maybe today they would sense their great need and yield and cry, yes, Lord Jesus, I trust you as my Savior. Yes, Lord Jesus, I believe that you died for me, was buried and raised from the dead, ascended back to the right hand of the Father, one day to return, and I trust you. The backslider needs to be revived. Revive them today. Fill their hearts. The indifferent one, Lord, bring them to a closer walk with you, that they might enter this exciting adventure of walking with the resurrected Christ. Do it, Father, for Jesus' glory and honor, and for the furtherance of his kingdom, that his name might be exalted. Do it for Jesus' sake. In his name we pray and give thanks. Amen.
Amen.
Remain standing, please, and turn in your Bible to the fourth chapter of the book of Acts. As we continue our verse-by-verse pilgrimage through this marvelous epistle, or I should say writing, historical writing of the New Testament. Any of our young people have not who want to go to the children's church, please feel free to do so. Acts chapter 4, let's pick up the narrative at verse 1. And as they spake unto the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. And it came to pass on the morrow that the rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and as many as were the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you and all and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which is become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. May the Lord's riches blessed be upon his word, and may it be sanctified in the hearts and minds of the people of God. You may be seated. I want to speak to you this morning just from a simple subject. No other name. No other name. I've been watching with careful attention to many of the talk shows, many of the seminars and workshops that's been conducted since 9/11. As a matter of fact, there was one this past week, I believe, that was convened on the hallowed grounds of the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia, where they were bringing together some of the thought leaders from the various religious persuasions. Thought leaders from Christianity, thought leaders from the Islamic community, thought leaders from the Jewish community. Because if nothing else, the 9/11 tragedy that sort of sensitized people to this whole issue of religion and a religious discussion. Cannot we all, in the words that great California theologian Rodney King, can we all just get along? So that's been one of the mantras that a lot of the seminars and discussions have been convened under. Can we not all get along? Cannot we all just coexist? And so when you start talking about coexistence, it's only natural that you would bring together the three monotheistic faiths, those faiths that believe there is but one God. We share that in common with the Islamic community. They believe in but one God, Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. And of course, the Jews believe that there is but one God. Here is the Lord, our God is one, as Moses writes in Deuteronomy 6. They believe that there is one God, Jehovah, Yahweh, in the Hebrew. And of course, in Christendom, we believe there is but one God, God the Father, eternally existent in three distinct persons, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So it's only natural that you pull together those who share that particular concept in common to discuss this whole idea of, can we not all coexist and get along in the name of God, since we all believe there is but one. And what you find is that the theologians from the various religious persuasions can find some common ground, and we ought to be trying to find common ground to get along on the earth that we might coexist. What we find happening is that when we start talking about it, there's one issue that always comes up and it creates some controversy. I was listening just the other night at C-SPAN, and then there's Dave O'Reilly, he was on, he had Jerry Falwell on, and then there was another group that was on, and they were saying the problem is that you Christians, y'all insist in this exclusivity of salvation. Y'all insist that unless a person believes that Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son of God, he's the only way to salvation. Y'all are so insistent and so intolerant. If y'all would just drop that particular mandate and say that we can all go to heaven any way we want to go, we can all coexist and get along well. What you're going to find happening more and more as we discuss this whole idea of, cannot we all get along in the name of one God, since we all believe in one God, you're going to find that the great division will come when the Christian community says that we believe in the exclusivity of the gospel. That there's no other name, as Peter says in Acts 4:12, under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. We don't say it mean-spirited. We don't say it with arrogance or spiritual pride. We say it as humble as we know how to say it. But we say what God has said and what his Christ has said and what our holy book is clear on delineating. There's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. What we find as we journey through the book of Acts, we find that this preaching of Christ as the Messiah, the anointed one, the only way of salvation, is what created all of the problem for the early church. If the early church would have just said, well, our brother Jude, since we're all children of Abraham, we can all just kind of get along, and we won't preach salvation through faith in Christ, we would just say, if you believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, if you hold to the monotheistic tenets of Judaism, if you observe all the Jewish rituals and rites, then you'll be okay. But they couldn't do it. But they knew in whom they had believed. They knew the message he called them to preach. Now, if we look at our text this morning in Acts chapter 4, it is actually a continuation of what we looked at last week in Acts 3. When we saw in Acts chapter 3 the day that the crippled pauper danced in church, the day that the man who had been born crippled, incapacitated, paralyzed, who had been set at the gate of the temple called Beautiful, begging for alms. He was 40 years old, and one day two poor preachers by the name of Peter and John, on their way to prayer meeting, encountered him and challenged him in the name of Jesus the Christ of Nazareth to rise up and walk. And by the power of God, his limbs received strength. He rose up and he walked. He leaped and he shouted and he praised God there in the temple. And that particular miracle got Peter and John in all kind of trouble. Because they would not accept the accolades. They would not accept the responsibility for healing this poor, lame pauper. Instead, they pointed to Jesus. And they said, this Jesus of Nazareth, the one that was betrayed, turned over to Pontius Pilate, sentenced to be crucified, was hung on a cross, placed in a tomb, but he's been raised from the dead. He sat on the right hand of God the Father, and now he's performing miracles on the earth. Now, understand the historical and the social and the cultural context. We're talking about early Palestine. We're talking about just several months after Jesus had been crucified. This Jesus who had created no small stir in Jerusalem, as a matter of fact, he had created tremendous controversy all over the landscape. So much so that the theological brain trust, the religious leaders who had control of the Jewish faith, they had came together and they had conspired together that we must get rid of him. He's gained too much popularity, too much influence, and too much of a following, and he's threatening the traditions that we have established, and he also threatens our political, social, and religious position and authority. Now look at the Bible closely, and you see that in Acts chapter 4, this was no small thing that happened. After this healing of this poor, crippled pauper, and after Peter and John said that Jesus did it, the religious leader says, we got a serious problem on our hands. We paid to have this man betrayed to be crucified. We got Pilate and we pressured Pilate into crucifying him. We wanted to do away with him because we didn't want his name being preached or taught. And now, months after his crucifixion, his apostles are still preaching in his name. Now pick up the text. That is the backdrop that you understand what is happening in Acts chapter 4. So when Luke writes, when he says in verse 1 or 4, he says the people, the priests, and captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came together. The significance here, the Sadducees came together because they were probably the most powerful religious group, the Sadducees. The Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection. So now you've got a serious problem. They have killed Jesus along with the scribes, the Pharisees, and the chief priests. And now the apostles are saying he's been raised from the dead, so their doctrine and their theological position now comes into question. And not only that, the influence that they were trying to eradicate, the influence of Jesus' life, is now continuing. So the Sadducees show up. Verse 2, and why were they so upset and grieved? They were grieved because they were preaching the resurrection. They arrested Peter and John, verse 3. However, 5,000 people got saved. Now when Peter preached on the day of Pentecost, 3,000 were saved. He now preaches in Acts chapter 3 and 5,000 get saved. God is adding to the church as it pleased him. Verse 5, and it came to pass on the next day, the rulers, the elders, the scribes, Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and as many were of the kin of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. We're talking about the entire brain trust come together. They convene a powerful meeting here to deal with two poor, pitiful preachers who don't have two dimes to rub together among them, but they have a message that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is alive and well. And so the religious leaders come together and say, how can we snuff out this movement before it builds momentum because we may be in a worse shape than what we were when Jesus was alive? So they come together. The first thing I have you to see is the interrogation. Verses 1 through 7. Verse 7, and when they asked them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you done this? Then Peter, being filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you and all to the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him, doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set in naught of you builders, which has become the heap, the head, or the chief cornerstone. So they interrogate Peter and John. They're blistering them with questions. How in the world, with this impotent, lame, poor pauper, how is he healed? How did it happen? They want an explanation. And so with rapid-fire succession, they're interrogating the two preachers. And then if you look there again at verse 8, what does it say? Then Peter, being what? Filled with the Holy Ghost. The Acts chapter 2 Pentecost experience of the filling of the Holy Ghost, it was for the day of Pentecost. For Peter to preach with power and with authority and with accuracy and with anointing on the day of Pentecost. But now when he is summoned in before the religious brain trust of Israel, it requires a new filling of the Holy Spirit. Are you following? You see, when we receive Christ, we are baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ, and we are filled with the Holy Spirit. But the filling of the Holy Spirit is an ongoing process. We must be being continuously filled with the Spirit, and the filling of the Spirit is yielding ourselves to the Word of God and yielding ourselves to the Spirit of God to allow Him to fill our lives with His presence and with His will. And so Peter there in front of these religious leaders, I'm sure he prayed, and God hears his prayer, and God fills him with the Spirit. And with the Spirit, there comes an anointing. God gives him the anointing, and he gives them the words to share on this particular occasion. And so what does Peter do under the filling of the Holy Spirit? He does what you always do when you're truly filled with the Holy Spirit. You exalt the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not the exaltation of men and women and boys and girls. It's not because of our skillfulness, intellect, or abilities. It's not because we work so hard or train so well. It's because Jesus Christ is alive, is what Peter says. It's because he is alive, he says, and he's living in and through us, and he's still doing miracles just as he was doing when he was here on the earth. And we're nothing more than the continuation of his life. We provide an ongoing venue for God to fill us with his Spirit, transport his power, so that his program and his kingdom can continue. Amen. So he chooses us as frail as we are, as weak as we are, as incompetent as we are, as problem and plagued down as we are, we're still God's servants. We are who he chooses. Not the mighty, not the noble, not the powerful, not the intellectual, but God has chosen the outscout of the earth so that no flesh can glory in his presence. And we know when God has used us, if we got any sense at all, we know it's not because of us. We know it's in spite of us. We know that, if we got any sense at all. It's not by our power or ability, because God, in his sovereign power, chooses to work through our frail, feeble, fragile lives to do his work. And so Peter had the sense to know. Peter knew I'm nothing more than an unlearned, ignorant preacher. That's what he was. And matter of fact, now I'm an ex-fisherman. I'm called to serve Christ. Peter and John, they knew what their capacities were. They knew what their limitations were. And they knew that this movement that had been created as a result of them yielding to God was not because of them. It was because of the living Christ. So he says, as Peter always says in his sermons, in his explanation during this interrogation, if you want to know who did this, it's Jesus. He's going to be really nail it down. It's the same one from Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. Even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Now again, he anchors his sermon in a Bible verse from Isaiah. That the stone which the builders rejected, God has made the chief cornerstone. God has made, put him at the top of everything. And so he explains what has taken place by saying it's because Jesus Christ is alive. And he emphasizes the resurrection of Christ. Note that. Now, won't you see something else here? In Peter's preaching, it was an exclusive message. The exclusivity of the message. Verse 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Lest you fall into a trap to think you're being narrow-minded, to think you're being bigoted, to think you're being non-intellectual when you say that a person can only be saved through faith in the resurrected Christ. When you take that position, you're in good company. You're in the company with the narrow-minded, bigoted, limited intellectually apostles who have been with Jesus. That's the message that they preached. And when Peter preached that message, he knew that he was going to be on a collision course with the popular message of the day. He knew that if Jesus was crucified for living his life, he knew that the same thing could befall him and the other apostles for preaching the resurrection of Christ from the dead. Are you understanding this? The early church did not expect for the world system to be accommodating to it. They knew that the movement of Christ had started in a hostile environment. Jesus went about doing good, healing folk who were sick, opening blinded eyes, feeding people that were hungry, encouraging broken hearts, but because it was a threat to the religious establishment and because he called them to repentance toward God, they put out a contract on his head that led to the high lynching that took place on Calvary. So Jesus was lynched for living a godly life. Peter, John, and James, and the other apostles, when they started preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ in the historical, cultural, social, and political context of Jerusalem, they knew that they were preaching a message that was an antithesis to what was believed in the culture. Are y'all with me this morning? Unfortunately, what has happened that in America, and we thank God for the fact that America, in its establishment, there are people who love God, who believe in God, who are serving the Lord Jesus Christ, and who wanted to establish a nation where people could worship God freely and without the encumbrances of the government. And so for the most part, in America, the government has always been on the side of Christianity. It has always been conducive, always protective of our rights and our freedoms, and always wanted to provide a venue where the gospel could be shared. But that is an anomaly. That's not a fact around the rest of the world. We got brothers and sisters in those former communist bloc countries. We got brothers and sisters in those totalitarian regimes who have served Christ always at the threat of losing their lives. We have brothers and sisters in Afghanistan and Saudi Arabia and Iran and Iraq, those Islamic countries who can be killed for preaching the gospel. And so their government and the social political system is not conducive and not palatable with the gospel being shared. We become fat, sassy, and lazy over here, thinking the government always going to be on our side. Eventually, sown into every nation are the seeds of his own damnation when it forgets God. And eventually, there will come a Pharaoh who didn't know Joseph, didn't know the God of Joseph, Abraham, or Isaac, and he will see where it's expedient and it's politically necessary to side with those who are hostile to Christianity. Are y'all listening to me? And so we've got to decide that regardless of the cost, that we identify with this lowly Nazarene and with power and with great boldness and great unction, we preach that neither the salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Understand me, I'm learning something in my old age. I'm not going out attacking other people's religion. Peter and John, they didn't attack other folks' religion. That's the problem with Christianity. We spend so much time attacking other people's religion that people don't know what it is we believe. No, what we've called to do is to herald the gospel, not attack Islam, not attack Judaism, not attack Hinduism. That's not what we're called to do. We're called to lay the truth down beside the lie, amen, to lay the standard down beside that which is not true, and allow God, the Holy Spirit, to take his truth, arrest men and women and boys and girls' minds and imagination to bring them to themselves so they can see the light of the gospel of Christ, to remove the scales and the shackles from their eyes that they might see that salvation in Christ is their only hope. That's what the church is called to do. And that's what Peter and John did. See, they didn't get caught up on sidetracked things. They weren't trying to explain everything about Judaism. No, they just preached Christ. Why? Because they were preaching to a Jewish audience, and they knew what the issue was. They knew the issue was this Jewish audience hated Jesus, had cried for his blood, wanted him to be crucified, and so he says, the one that you crucified is your only hope. Then until you're willing to change your mind about him, there's no hope for you. So it's no use us going to point number B, he says, that you deal with point A. What are you going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with Christ? What think you of he whose son is he? And so Peter, just relentlessly, he just explained that Jesus has done this. Jesus healed this man. Jesus is responsible for what took place. Look at verse 15. But when they had commanded them to go outside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, the religious leaders, saying, what shall we do to these men? For indeed, a notable miracle hath been done by them, is manifest in all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. You see, what the church is called to do, as we've shared before, is to witness with our words by what we say, and to witness by our walk and how we live, to witness by our worship how we praise and magnify God, and also to witness by our work. We've got to have some work, ladies and gentlemen. We got to have some work that cannot be denied. They could not deny the fact that through Peter and John, God had wrought this great miracle. So even the enemies of the cross had to come to grips with the fact that a noble miracle has been performed, and we can't deny it. We cannot deny it. We cannot disprove it. And so as we, by the power of the Holy Spirit, preach the gospel, as people are saved, as their lives are changed and transformed, as habits are broken, as addictions are broken, as people are growing in grace in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we then can bring those people whose lives were broken, were bruised, battered, manhandled, and mauled, those people who were disfigured by sin, and now God has miraculously transformed their lives, and we got some work to say. Jesus did this. You might not believe what we say, you might not accept what we're doing, but you have to come to grips with the fact that Jesus is changing people's lives. I was doing some reading some months ago and checking up on some of these substance abuse clinics and places and so forth. Of all of the substance abuse places in the country that is documented, the most effective substance abuse clinic in terms of lowest recidivism of the people recidivating back into substance abuse is Teen Challenge. Teen Challenge is a faith-based substance abuse program started by a man by the name of David Wilkerson. He wrote a book some years ago, The Cross and the Switchblade. As a minister in the inner city of New York, he was able to lead some of the most notorious gangs and warlords in New York to Christ. The most famous man by the name of Nicky Cruz, who was a murderer and a thug, but came to faith in Christ and became a very powerful witness for Christ. So they have the most effective 80%+ rate of success for those who go to Teen Challenge, stay in the program, come out the other side. Yet, the government wanted to shut them down. There were people who did not like the fact that this faith-based organization had such high success rates, and they were receiving some government funds to do the substance abuse program, and so in Texas, there was a major war that was fought in Texas over this. Fortunately, by the grace of God, they were able to prevail. They tried to shut them down. Because when you took what the people of God were doing, and you put that alongside what the social, secular society was doing, they were spending millions of dollars and had almost no results. The people of God's program was getting results, so the secular said, we got to close them down. If we don't close them down, they're going to close us down. There's always a collision course. But the church still has to be preaching the gospel. People's lives being changed so that we have work manifesting the lives and changed lives. And so the people have to come to grips with something about the movement of the believers. Amen. Just a couple more minutes and I'll be through. Verse 17, so the leader says, but that it spread no further among the people, let us straightly threaten them, that they speak henceforth no more in this name. And they called them and commanded them not to speak at all, nor teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said unto them, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken to you more than God, judge ye. Peter says, should I listen to you, or should I listen to God? Should I obey you, or should I obey God? And some of you know yourselves, because some of you are in very high stature and high profile in the community. You know they invite you to come and pray at some of these big meetings. They say, well, just don't pray in Jesus' name. You can come and you can pray, and you can pray to God, but we got some people in the audience who might be offended if you pray in Jesus' name. Now, I did that once in my life, and I was so ashamed of myself. Before God said, Lord, if I ever do it again, just take me on out of the word. If I ever again deny you just because some people are concerned about whether or not somebody's going to be offended if I pray in Jesus' name. There ain't no other name to pray to. Amen. There ain't nobody else out there listening to us. great, benign, beneficent God up there who doesn't exist. And we have no access to the throne room of God except in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Peter says, and you judge, we know what we got to do. Because we are held hostage by our own convictions and by our own belief. We can't deny our own experience. You cannot deny your own experience. Remember a few years ago I preached a sermon from in the Gospels dealing with Peter's denials of Jesus. He denied him with his lips three times. As a matter of fact, on the third time, he denied him with profanity. But then Jesus looked at him, and the Bible says Peter went away and cried and he wept. He could deny him with his lips, but he couldn't deny him in his heart. He knew that he knew him. He knew that he knew Christ. He had been with Christ. He had been exposed to Christ. And so even though he tried to deny him outwardly on the inside, he was crushed and convicted because he knew he was one of his. We cannot deny him. That's what Peter says in verse 20. He says, we cannot speak the things we have seen and heard. We can only talk about what we know to be true. This is not fable or fairy tale. This is something we know. We've experienced it to be true. So verse 21, when they further threatened them and they let them go, finding nothing how they might punish them, because the people of all men glorified God for that which was done. So they let them go. Now look at verse 24. And when they heard that, they lift up their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, thou art God, which hath made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them is, who by the mouth of thy servant David hath said, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? The kings of the earth stood up and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For of truth, against thy holy child Jesus, whom thou anointed, both Herod, Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together for to do whatsoever thou hand, thou counsel determined before to be done. Stop right there. There was the interrogation before the religious leaders. There was the explanation by Peter. And after their release, there was a great celebration. They go back to the fellowship. You see, when you're witnessing, when you're sharing your faith, when you're bearing witness to the rallying of the resurrected Christ, you ought to be excited to get back to the fellowship. So you can celebrate with the fellowship. So you can celebrate and tell the fellowship what great things God has wrought in and through your witness and your testimony. Can I get some help today? Yeah. So Peter and John, they go back to the fellowship and they lift up their voices in the fellowship with testimony, with praise and with worship and with prayer to God for what he has done. They anchor it all in the word of God. If you note there, Peter again quotes from the book of Psalm and he interprets the ungodly's reaction to the heathen raging against God and raging against his Christ and being angry against God because God is righteous and they're unrighteous. But look at what he prays. Look at what he prays. He does not pray, Lord, give me a brand new chariot pulled by eight Clydesdales, adorn me in the finest regalia of the day, and let me be in the Budweiser, Michelob, whatever the commercial is for the Clydesdales in. No, look at what he says. Verse 29 of Acts 4. And now, Lord, behold, thy threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word. By stretching forth thy hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. Amen. And so they pray to God. Lord, give us boldness. We know that we got adversaries out there. We know there's organized opposition out there in the religious, in the political, in the social world. We know that, Lord, but give us boldness to stand up in face of all the opposition and to not flinch, to not stutter, to not blink, or to not bow down, but to declare Jesus Christ is the only hope of salvation. To be like those three Hebrew boys in the book of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They said, O king, live forever. But even if you throw us in the fiery furnace, we cannot bow down. We will not bend, we will not bow, and by the grace of God, we will not burn, because God will protect us when we find ourselves in the crucible of suffering, when we try to do his work. They understood that. They understood that the organized religious and political system would at some point in time set a bullseye upon them. They understood. And they understood that if I emulate Jesus, if I act like he acted, talk like he talked, do the things that he did, teach like he taught, preach like he preached, they understood that I'm going to get persecuted. Not praised. In the church today, we expect always to be praised. Don't get me wrong. I'm no glutton for pain. I got a very low threshold for pain, physical, emotional, spiritual, any kind. Very low threshold. It's only by the grace of God are we able to stand. But the church must understand that to be uniquely and distinctly the church, the people of God, would often put us in a position where the world criticizes us because we say that there's salvation but one way. Not many ways. We're not all going to heaven just because we try to do good. We're not all going just because we try to obey the golden rule. Just like Disney World. You don't have a ticket, you don't get in. You don't go in just because you like Mickey Mouse. You go in if you've paid the fare. And we only go into heaven if our fare has been paid, because we cannot pay for ourselves. And the only one that can pay is the one who has paid. And that's the Lord Jesus. Well, if we preach this message with boldness, with clarion clarity. You see, there's so much confusion out there that it's important that the church just kind of sets the record straight. That salvation is through faith in the finished work of Christ. And if you have real salvation, then your life will change. You cannot encounter the living God. It is impossible to encounter him and to remain the same. And so if you remain the same after a profession of faith in the resurrected Christ, maybe you really didn't come to know him. Now, I'm not saying you have to be perfect, but I'm saying you got to change. He loves us too much to leave us like he found us. And I know the songwriter, and I love the song, and I've sung the song myself. Please be patient with me. God is not through with me yet. I understand that, but the question is, has he began? Has he started? We know he's not through. That's evident. That's obvious that he's not through. But the question is, has he began a good work in you? Because if he began a good work in you, you will change. Your attitude will change. Your values will change. Your language will change. Your lifestyle will change. The way you treat people will change. The way you talk will change. The place you go will change. You will change. You cannot remain the same. Cannot remain the same and come to know him. And that's what Peter and John was talking about. They could not be talked out of this. They knew that they had met the risen Christ. They knew that their lives had been changed. These were two guys. Peter had a temper the boy could curse like a sailor. John crying, God, bring them fire to heaven to consume people. The same John we call the apostle of love, the boy was a renegade, wanting God to consume people with fire. But Christ got a hold of his heart.
Amen.
And when Christ got a hold of his heart melted down. And the boy who was a son of thunder changed in John. He became known as the apostle of love. Because God changed his heart. Wouldn't let him stay the same. Changed him. 180. Turned him around. He'll do it for you. He'll do it for you. If you're here this morning wondering, yes, there's hope for you. If you never come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, there's hope for you. God wants to save you. He wants to forgive you. He wants to cleanse you. He wants to begin a good work in you. And he wants to use you. He wants to use you. Listen to me. The God of the universe wants to use you in his program to accomplish his work. That's an awesome thought. That's the truth of the Bible. you're here this morning, you sense a need, you have a desire to surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, I encourage you to do it. You don't have to understand 99.99% of what I say. But if you understand and are willing to accept, I know that I am a sinner. I sinned against God. I know that. And I know I can't undo the things I've done. And I know I can't make myself right with God. But I believe that God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross to shed his blood for my sins. That Christ died in my place. And I believe that God raised him from the dead on the third day by his own power. And I trust him for my salvation. If you will pray that prayer, you receive Christ. That's all you need to know. Amen. That's all you need to know. And you begin this exciting adventure. The Christian life is an exciting adventure. From moment to moment, hour to hour, day to day, watching God unveil his work in and through us. And just when we think he's given up on us, he calls us to toss us to the trash heap. He comes and pick us up. He picks us up. He picks us up. And so you're still my child. I still can use you in my program. That's an awesome thought. Humbles my heart every single day. It was all of my dysfunction, for all of my problems, for all of my weaknesses, with all the confusion that swirls around in my head, and with all the controversy that surrounds my life, God said I can still use you in my program. And so I said, Lord, I'll show up again today. I will show up again today if you can still use me in my program. In your program. Let's bow for prayer, shall we? Father, I pray that you would stir a heart today. I pray, Lord, you'll move and call someone here to yourself today. Someone here, their heart is heavy, Lord. They're laboring under the burden of sin. There's problems in their life that they're trying to figure out that they never will be able to figure out without your help. I pray that you move in their heart right now. There's someone here, Lord, that's backslidden. They need to repent, and they need to re-identify with Christ. You know, do a work in the hearts of your people and those you call to be your people. In Jesus' name. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here this morning, and you just sense a need, you have a desire just to get right with God, if you want to be saved, just raise your hand right where you are. And in lifting your hand, you're lifting your hand to the Lord. And you say, Lord, I want to be saved. Is there one? There's hope for you. There's hope for you. It's not over. God hasn't given up on you. There's still hope for you. When you come to him today, spiritual need.